Dear students, in this lecture we will study ruby laser. Ruby laser is the first type of laser which is constructed by Theodor Maimon in 1960. Ruby is a crystal of alumina Al2O3 in which some of the aluminium 3 plus ions are replaced by chromium 3 plus ions, that is 0.05% by weight of aluminium 3 plus ions are replaced by chromium 3 plus ions. Chromium ions constitute the active centers, whereas the aluminium and oxygen atoms are inert. Principle of ruby laser. It is a 3-level laser and also it is a solid state laser. Ruby rod is used as an active medium and chromium ions acts as an active center. The pumping method which is used in ruby laser is optical pumping method, which is used to achieve population inversion. I have explained population inversion in my previous lecture. The wavelength of the laser beam emitted using ruby laser is 6943 angstroms or 694.3 nanometers. Let us look at the construction of ruby laser. The arrangement of laser is as shown in figure 1. It consists of ruby cylindrical rod, typically 5 cm long and 0.5 cm in diameter, whose ends are optically flat and accurately parallel. One end is fully silvered and other end is partially silvered. The rod is surrounded by a glass tube. The glass tube is surrounded by helical xenon flash tube, which acts as the optical pumping system, which is in yellow color, which is as shown in this schematic diagram in yellow color. And the laser beam, which is the output of this ruby laser, is red color, which is as shown in the schematic diagram in red color arrow marks. Now we will see the working of ruby laser. The energy level diagram of chromium ions in ruby crystal is as shown in figure 2. That is E1, E2, E3, E4. The chromium ions are excited from level E1 to level E3 by the absorption of light of wavelength 550 nanometers from the xenon flash tube. That means chromium ions from ground state E1 will go to excited state E3 by means of optical pumping with a light of wavelength 550 nanometer from the xenon flash tube. The excited ions quickly undergo non-radiative transitions to the level E2. From this excited state E3, they will come to metastable state E2 by non-radiative decay. That means without emitting any radiation, they will come to E2 from E3. With a transfer of energy to the lattice, thermal motion. Energy difference between E3 and E2 will be taken by lattice thermal motion. The E2 level is a metastable state with a lifetime of about 3×10⁻³ seconds. That is, it is in the order of milliseconds. Usual atomic lifetimes are 10⁻²⁸ seconds. That means it has a long lifetime in metastable state when we compared with the lifetime of atom or ion in excited state like E3 and E4. Now, the population of E2 level becomes greater than that of the E1 level because of the continuous pumping process. At this stage, we can say the population inversion is achieved. Some photons are produced by spontaneous transition from E2 to E1, have a wavelength of 694.3 nanometer. The ends of the ruby rod acts as reflecting mirrors. Therefore, photons that are not moving parallel to the ruby rod escape from the side, but those moving parallel to it are reflected back and forth. These stimulate the emission of similar other photons the chain reaction quickly develops a beam of photons all moving parallel to the rod, which is monochromatic and is coherent. When the beam develops sufficient intensity, it emerges through the partial silvered end. This is the ruby rod. Whenever there is a spontaneous transition from E2 to E1, we'll imbibe the ground state atom to excite again and again, or ground state ions to move from E1 to E2. This process will continue. Those photons which are parallel to this ruby rod will come out of this half-silvered side of the ruby rod. Those who are in random direction, or which are not in the direction of this parallel beam, they will excite the atoms which are in the ground state. Once all the chromium ions in the metastable level have returned to the ground level, the laser stops, laser action stops. It is then necessary to send one more flash of pumping radiation through the rod. Thus, the ruby laser operates only in pulses. The ruby laser operates only in pulses, even in the short period of few microseconds in which ruby is lasing. We find that the emission is made up of spikes of high intensity emission, as shown in figure 3. This phenomenon is known as spiking of the laser. It is first observed in experiments with ruby by Collins and other scientists. That means the output of the ruby laser is in the form of pulses. This is the power time graph of the output of the ruby laser. It clearly shows output is a pulses. Advantages of ruby laser. Ruby lasers are economical. The beam diameter of ruby laser is comparatively less than carbon dioxide laser. The output power of the ruby laser is more than helium neon laser, which we will study in the next lecture. Since the ruby laser is in solid form, there is no chance of wastage of active material. Disadvantages of ruby laser. Even though there are advantages, some of the disadvantages of ruby laser are: the efficiency of ruby laser is comparatively low. The optical cavity of ruby laser is short as compared to other lasers. There is no significant stimulated emission occurs until at least half of the ground state electrons exited to the metastable state. This is the main requirement of a laser in order to get lasing action. Therefore, population inversion should be achieved. Applications of this ruby lasers are: it is used in pulsed holography, and it is used to range some of the objects, or it is used in ranging experiments. It is used to remove tattoos. Also, it is used to remove skin lesions resulting from excess melanin. This is all about ruby laser. Thank you.